Right, I think it's time for another race car update. The last time you'd have seen this, that has been at Cadwell, where unfortunately on the last lap the engine gave way. So that was that. If you haven't watched any of my previous videos, I'll insert a clip of when it went. Now, the next race was Silverstone, which was MG Live, and I was frantically trying to get an engine that was only like 4 weeks away from when the engine went. So I was frantically trying to get a scrapyard engine to get it into the car and get it running. Now, I did find an engine but I couldn't get it until I think it was like 3 or 4 days before the race, and that was just too much stress to get it on and get it running and not properly test the engine basically. Anyway, so this engine turned up. I went to MG Live and had a good time. That was okay. It wasn't nothing to scream and shout about compared to other years, but it was good. Watched some racing and looked really good. So we come back from there, and the race after Silverstone was Donington. So we were frantically trying to get the car done, got the engine in. Well, I pulled it apart and stuck a head gasket in, time and bell, water pump, all that sort of stuff. And I'll stick some photos of that process. I didn't film any of it. I took some photos. I just wanted to get it done to make the race. Anyway, this is a scrapyard engine, and this is a 160 engine from a TF. So MEMS free, and it had the oil cooler. As you know, of this is now the fourth engine, and it keep spinning bearings. So there's a reason for that. I don't know the reason. The oil temperatures were fine, coolant temperatures were fine, and then it just started knocking and everything just skyrocketed up. So I don't know what's happened. It's always number three bearing in the last two engines, so there's an issue there somewhere. So I wanted to get one with a standard oil cooler and still run the oil to air cooler that I've got at the front. So anyway, I fitted this engine and it looked like it's been dropped a million times. So we got on the stands, we went through it, took the sump off, fitted a sump baffle, because the previous one was destroyed, and we time belt, water pump, all that sort of jazz, and stuck it on. Now the oil cooler pipes that runs from the oil filter to the oil cooler look like they're a little bit rusty, and they didn't look at the best conditions. I tried to get a set and couldn't get a set because they're no longer available. So I just chanced it, got up and running the Thursday before. I think the race was the Saturday, and lo and behold, they leaked. So there's obviously been dropped on there at some point and just split the pipe. So that was that. Didn't make Donington. So we then searched for some oil pipes, and a set came up on eBay. Really, brand spanking new set, just been taken out of the bag, a lot of photos. And I managed to snap them up. So that was that, really. I think what I'll do is I'll stick some photos of the damage. I'll take you over to the engine. The block is scrap. And this is another block that I've got because I'm trying to build the parts up to, try and build a spare engine. So I've always got a spare engine. So 160 head. This is the one that I built. The liners are really scored. All three of them. Rod and piston is, I've chucked that in the bin. I've chucked the crank in the bin. This is another crank. I've got a set of rods and pistons at the machine shop at the minute, having the pistons put onto the rod because these are heat, so you heat that bit up so it expands and then you push the pin in and then it cools and shrinks on it. So the movement is actually done in the piston, not in the little end. But you can probably see that. Oh, that's a bearing, that is. So that should be fine. But this is part of the rod. This is the top half of the piston. And again, I'll stick some photos in it of what it actually looks like. So this is the head gasket I was using. So that was the paying newest style. This is the damage to the oil rail. So that is scrap. That's the oil pickup. Loads of bits in there. This is the sump baffle. So yeah, that's might be able to straighten that out and reuse that, but I've got another one in the other engine anyway. So this is a spare block that I've got. I think that crank is knackered as well because that's the first crank that it spun a bearing on. This is just a spare crank. The other crank is long gone. It's in the bin. I think all the valves are all good, but I might send the head off for a refresh anyway. But yeah, I'll stick the photos of the damage in now.
Under pressure, no more time. Can we make a move? Overthinking, you and I. What do we have to lose?
Right, so getting back to this one, I've had to convert this from MEMS 3 to MEMS 2J. So the intake is different, the coil's different. And normally, you can probably see down there if I put a torch, the coil packs. They're normally bolted onto the side of the engine, but because I've got the oil cooler, I've had to relocate them coil packs. So that was another job that we had to do. At the minute, I've got two ECUs. I've got one chipped, one standard. Now, when we last couple of races that we had, as you was down gearing, it would hold when you put your clutch down change it down a gear, that would hold its revs at about 4,000 to 5,000 RPM. So I was thinking that I had an air leak or a sensor that was gone. So I changed the manifold with all different new sensors, not new sensors, but secondhand sensors that I know were good. And that was still the same. So I then swapped over to the ECU, a standard ECU, and problem gone. So I don't know if this ECU was damaged before I sent it away, because this is ECU that I've got secondhand off eBay. I sent it away to be chipped and then brought it back. Whether that's damaged before or not, I don't know, because I haven't had the car running on that ECU, because you need the 5AS or the BCU, whatever you want to call it, the immobilizer pack, to run it. And I only bought the engine ECU, so I couldn't run it because it wouldn't talk to the 5AS. So that was that. Once it's chipped, the immobilizer's gone, so you ain't got to worry about it, to plug it in and play. But what I'm going to do is, last time I had it rolling road, I made 160 horsepower, which was a bit strange because I was running a 160 engine. The best exhaust, the best intake that you could possibly get for it. I didn't have the intake at the time. I had a pipe cross enclosed filter. So I've now upgraded to an ITG, which is one of the best you can get for these engines. So it might be an idea to have it re-dynoed with the chipped ECU to see what power it's now making, and then switch back over to the standard ECU to see what it's making, and then to reset all the parameters. You can do like parameter reset, and sometimes that can give you a few extra horsepowers. So we might do that in a later video, but not today. Anyway, we digress. So the engine is in, it all starts, all runs, all good. Nothing else has been changed to the car. It's literally just engine in and done. I will raise you up.
You raise me up so I can't stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong.
I'll show you underneath because you'll be able to see. Left my torch up there now, haven't I? Let me come back to you.
A few minutes later.
Right, I've now got my torch, so I can show you what I'm on about. So, these are the coil oil pipes that go into the oil filter housing. You can see I've still got the aftermarket oil cooler on there. They go all the way around the engine, and then they go, if I can show you, it's very weird, but very tight to show you. There, that is the oil cooler, and it's just literally a coolant that cools the oil. So my thought and thinking was that it's going to help cool the oil, and if it gets too hot, then the coolant is going to cool it down. Or if the car gets too coolant gets too hot, then the oil is going to cool the coolant down, because I've got the oil to air. I hope it's going to maintain the right temperature. But I've got my temperature gauge all working now, and it actually reads spot on to what the oil temperature gauge for the car shows on the actual values. So you put a computer in, let's say it's running 78 degrees or 80 degrees, let's say, bring it up to road numbers, and actually on the aftermarket gauge, it actually shows it's on the spot on the 80 mark. So that's all good. So that is the only thing that we've got, really. As I say, I just wanted to keep you updated to what's going on with this, because I said that I was going to film the process of doing the engine and fitting it, but I just wanted to get it done, and we didn't make Donington anyway. So the next race is actually Alton Park. I won't be going to that one, which is the 2nd or 3rd of September, because the wife's away on holiday. Unfortunately, I've got to look after my own kids. So that is that. So the next one that I'll be doing will be Snetterton, which is the last race of the season. So instead of doing 5 races of the season, I'm only doing 3. So, you know, the idea was to do the 5 races and to start and finish every race to then keep the points up. So I then somewhere in the mid-table, but at the minute as it stands, I'm 6th. I was 4th, but because I didn't do Silverstone or Donington, I'm now back to 5th in 6th in class. So I run class A. So that is that. That is just a short video on progress of the race car. We are good to go. The only thing I've got to do really is to give it a good run down the road, get it all up to temperature, and just make sure it's okay, and then we'll probably stick it on the dyno and see what it says, see if we've gained any power, lost any power to what it was last time. It was really cold last time. It was like 2 or 3 degrees when we dynoed the last time. So the intake air temperatures will be perfect, but probably not this time. It's going to be in the 20s, I'd imagine. But that's that. And also, I have purchased another vehicle which we might be building for the MG Cup to be a Class C car. Too far. There we go. MGZS 180. So we'll probably be building that at some point. But I'm not overly sure on that as yet. So I'm going to leave it here. Again, it's just a short video, just for an update of what's going on with this, what the plans are for the rest of the season. And hopefully the next time you'll see this will be either at the dyno, or we might get a track evening in at some point, just to test it, just to make sure all the coolant is happy and good to go. Right, lower this back down. See you in the next video.